The nation is being literally split in half. Or at least that was the case 1.1 billion years ago, as a 2,200-mile-long series of rifts developed which stretched all the way from Oklahoma to Michigan back to Alabama. From many of these rifts, large volumes of molten rock erupted, in some cases involving actual floods of lava termed flood basalts that would eventually leave behind more than 10 miles thick of igneous and volcanic rocks. These complex of rifts, known as the Midcontinental Rift, nearly broke a segment of ancient North America in two, possibly three segments, as the land was pulled apart to the east and west. As a result, for many millions of years, much of what would later become the United States was reminiscent of the modern Danakil Depression in Ethiopia, with abundant volcanoes and lava flows. And yet, the aforementioned rifting would eventually fail, leaving behind lowered areas of topography that would later be infilled by Lake Superior alongside many incredibly valuable ore deposits. So, why exactly did this rift system form in the first place? At the time, the continent Laurentia contained much of the modern continental United States, Canada, and Greenland in a single landmass. Yet, due to long-term geologic forces, part of this continent was slowly stretching apart, meaning that eventually a series of rifts in the landscape would pop up at the weakest spot in the region. And this is exactly what happened 1.11 billion years ago, when then weak rifting interacted with an unusually hot patch of rising mantle material. Known as a hotspot or a mantle plume, its mushroom-shaped mass at the mantle crust boundary had a temperature of 1400 degrees Celsius, while surrounding mantle material merely had a temperature of 1200 degrees Celsius. Due to being hotter and less dense than the surrounding material, the mantle plume's head soon interacted with the crust, sending tremendous volumes of magma into it. At the same time, the buoyancy of the magma caused the overlying crust to slowly spread apart, greatly amplifying the ongoing rifting. Within several million years, a 3,500-kilometer-long rift had formed from which abundant molten rock erupted, occurring alongside many igneous intrusions. In some spots, molten rock erupted at rates exceeding 10,000 cubic meters per second, flooding parts of the rift valley which had formed in individual eruptions which emplaced up to 20,000 feet thick of basalt. This volcanism continued in some spots for the next 25 million years, depositing 2.8 million cubic kilometers of molten rock. This was sufficient to hypothetically cover the entire of the modern United States and 932 feet thick of lava flows, except it largely occurred in a narrow area ranging from what is now Oklahoma to Michigan to Ontario. These basalts were unusually enriched in copper, with average values exceeding 3 times the average background concentrations of this element in Earth's crust. However, around 1.085 billion years ago, the ongoing rifting ceased altogether, and there is a key reason for this. The Midcontinental Rift had been accommodating expansional forces on the continent, but much of these forces would reverse to compression when a new mid-ocean ridge, a form of divergent plate boundary, formed to the continent's southeast. Much of the aforementioned Midcontinental Rift was then largely filled with sandstone and conglomerate sedimentary rocks, and some spots were temporarily filled with lakes or even an inland small sea that caused significant volumes of seawater to penetrate into the crust. As a large chunk of the crust sunk downwards, the unusually sulfur-poor basalt rocks began to undergo metamorphism. Heated by increasing temperatures at depth, the seawater slowly began leaching large volumes of copper from the flood basalts, carrying it and other elements where they existed in elevated concentrations upwards as it rose through the crust. As temperatures decreased, cobalt and nickel arsenides precipitated first, along with silver compounds at temperatures of around 500 degrees Celsius. After these cooled, many of these deposits were replaced by copper arsenides at around 220 degrees Celsius. Other mineral resources were also in place, including titanium, vanadium, niobium, rare earth elements, and even uranium. While these deposits were largely emplaced in Michigan's Upper Peninsula, Ontario, Minnesota, and Wisconsin, it is possible that other valuable ore deposits were emplaced elsewhere in the failed Midcontinental Rift. However, outside of these areas, almost everything was buried by many kilometers of sedimentary rock, leaving few surface exposures outside of the region surrounding Michigan. I hope that you found today's video interesting, allowing you to understand why some regions of the Midwest are geologically similar.